as you know, a research issue partly, as is said in the guidelines, but it's something we face every day in clinical practice. And the question is how to handle this specifically. 3 points. First is a physiologic feature of the cardiovascular system, but when increased, it might be a problem. And this opens the windows for possible treatment. What should we do? Let's start with the very basic stuff, and there's nothing new here. Stephen Hales, 1700, the first blood pressure measurement in the history. You see the assistant indicating the level of blood in this glass pipe introducing an artery of the mare. And he was surprised by the fluctuations of the blood in the pipe. So he discovered blood pressure variability for the first time, and he was able to write that blood pressure continuously fluctuates to such a degree that the same 2 minutes of blood pressure will never be seen throughout the whole life of an animal, something remarkable. I would love to have been able to write myself. And this was written in 1733. And this is physiology, basically. I used to show my student this slide. It's an intra-tibial recording in a subject at rest, no movement, nothing, he's not talking. Blood pressure is never stable. As you know, blood pressure becomes still only when you die. Until you are alive, you have to face some variability, and this is part of daily physiology. And this is a problem when you have to measure blood pressure, you need repeated measurements, but you have to understand what is behind these fluctuations. We tried to summarize this in a review paper a couple of years ago. You see the different components of blood pressure variability, the very short term, beat by beat, short term over 24 hours, midterm, day by day, you can measure with a home monitoring, or long term, visit to visit, seasonal, yearly, whatever. There are several different mechanisms, including sympathetic activity, arterial stiffness, aging, humoral factors, physical behavior, respiration, and these are all interacting in modifying the features of this phenomenon. And there is a lot of evidence, mainly from observational studies, that whenever there is an increase in any of these components, you have higher rate of organ damage, events, mortality, although this is again based on observational studies mostly. And you have to measure this with different methods. If you stay in the short-term frame, you need bit-by-bit recording, intra-arterial or non-invasive, whatever. Over the 24-hour, the ABPM, the classic oscillometric approach, is fine. On the day-to-day, you might use home monitoring, but some people still repeat also ambulatory or clinic in the same frame. And finally, in the long-term, the best is using the repeated well taken measurements during clinic visits. And if you go to continuous monitoring, the first step was the intra-arterial line, the Oxford. We did a lot of work in this in the 70s, 80s. Very detailed assessment, 100,000 values, but invasive. Then we developed together with our Dutch colleague the Finapress and its portable version, the Portapress. And if you compare an intra-arterial line with the Portapress recording, you find quite nice similarities, mainly for blood pressure fluctuation, in spite of being at the finger level, although you may have some degree of smoothing with the software modifying the pulse waveform. And this has been used in many settings. Now we are using the oscillometric approach. Starting from the 60s to nowadays, there is a lot of technological improvement, and this is more readily acceptable by patients. And you can get information on different components of the 24 hours, daytime, nighttime, the dipping, the morning surge, the overall variability, and specific behaviors. And these are the indices you may use, a number of mathematical modeling, not always so simple, but in general easy to apply, also because they are implemented in many of the softwares for analyzing a blood pressure recording. And you can focus on overall variability, including day, night, and all the changes, or be selective, excluding the day, night change, because this is very specific in pathophysiology, and just focusing on reading to reading or short-term changes. And finally, you can focus on the extreme, the range, the maximum or minimum in a given time frame, which have all been used in different studies. These are the measures most commonly used for short-term changes. The average daytime and nighttime standard deviation, better if weighted for the number of reading, so you separately calculate day and night, and then you skip the day versus night changes, or the average real variability, so-called, which is the mean of the absolute difference between consecutive readings, very short term. Or you can use the spectral analysis in the frequency domain, and you can single out this lowest component, the day-night, the siesta, if you want, and just focus on the fastest changes. This is how the weighted standard deviation is computed. You see, overall, you have 15.5 millimeter of mercury, 24-hour standard deviation, including everything. If you separately assess daytime and nighttime, you have 9.0, 8.9. So if you average them out, and this is the average weighted standard deviation, you find a lower standard deviation because you are not including day-night. The overall standard deviation is related to the dipping, so depends on the day-night changes. The weighted standard deviation does not. So it's a short-term measure independent of day-night changes. And again, you have to measure blood pressure frequently enough. If you don't have at least a measurement every 15 minutes, you have longer interval, you might fall into trouble. This is an intra-arterial recording with modeling. We're programming the computer to take a value every 5, 10, 15, 30 or 60 minutes. When the interval between readings is longer than 15 minutes, as we commonly do with ABPM, you start having major errors in the calculation of blood pressure variability. And then you can use the spectral analysis. You can separate the different frequency components that appear in the spectrum as peaks, which is done commonly in the engineering world. You can also focus on specific components, the morning surge, for example. But also here you have many methods. You can focus on the lowest and the highest value in the morning, on the pre-awake and the morning, or the pre-sleep and the morning. You get different results. So we need more standardization here. And in general, as I said before, if you consider the entire 24-hour blood pressure profile, you might need to separately analyze the so-called protective components, the blood pressure fall when you sleep, which indicates reduction in sympathetic activity, separately from the fast changes reflecting sympathetic activation in response to stress. And let's go to the second point then. If we have this kind of methodology, we try to apply this in understanding whether this is clinically meaningful. And we have many studies showing that an increase in blood pressure variability is related to organ damage, morbidity, mortality, events. Of course, as I said, always in a frame of an observational trial. This was probably the first study in the field. We published this when I was a young doctor many years ago, still using intra-arterial monitoring, and we split the people into five groups of mean 24-hour values, and for any given mean pressure level, we had two classes, lower or higher variability. The organ damage overall score was increasing with the mean pressure, that's hypertension basically, but if you compare yellow and red bars, whenever there was an increase in variability for the same mean level, there was an independent contribution to organ damage. People analyzed this in different ways, also focusing on nocturnal dipping, again by accounting for the mean blood pressure level, that's the SISTUR study in the elderly, an increase in night-to-day ratio, which means less dipping means more events. Morning surge, mainly in the eastern country. We know that in the morning we have a higher rate of stroke, myocardial infarction, and many events, which does not necessarily mean that this depends on the blood pressure surge, but it is associated. And indeed, in the Oasama study in Japan, they showed that those having the highest quintile of morning surge were having the highest rate of hemorrhagic stroke. That's typical in a Japanese population, might not be typical in a Mediterranean population. That is studied by Paolo Verdecchia in Italy. It showed exactly the opposite. The highest events rate was in those with the smallest morning surge. Why? Because they were non-dipper. And this is highlight a very practical issue. If you are dipping at night, which is good, you might also need to have a morning surge. Otherwise, you cannot get up. If you are non-dipper, you might not have a morning surge, but the non-dipping in itself is a risky condition. That's why we need to standardize very well this methodology to avoid these pitfalls. And indeed, we tried in the frame of the PAMELO study to calculate the impact on cardiovascular mortality in this general population in 12-year follow-up by focusing separately on the dipping. Anytime there is a reduced dipping, there was an increase in mortality, and the short-term blood pressure changes computed independently and simultaneously from the dipping. So whenever there is an increase in the short-term residual variability, again, there was an increase in cardiovascular mortality, something to consider. We also recently tested this in renal patients. It's a very risky population, and summarizing evidence available. And again, if you stratify these patients based on the nocturnal dipping, the higher the blood pressure at night, the lower the dipping, the higher the risk of end-stage renal disease events. So that's a serious issue here. Long-term, day-to-day, week-to-week, season-to-season, or visit-to-visit. Using home monitoring, you can quantify the variability between days. The highest the day-by-day variability, the highest the mortality. Again, the Iwasawa study in Japan. And Peter Rothwell was focusing on the visit-to-visit variability. Again, even if this was a retrospective analysis with some limitation, the evidence was that the increased visit-to-visit fluctuation in pressure was associated with a higher risk of stroke and coronary events, which might indicate less control, instability of hypertension control by treatment, which makes sense. Last point, if this is true, we may consider doing something, and that's not an easy issue. You may at least take care of the blood pressure profile. Theoretically, if you want to reduce blood pressure in this patient, you have to downshift this profile respecting the physiology of 24-hour changes. If you are not, as it happens often with short-lasting drugs given once a day, you might have an escape at the end of the recording with an increase in variability in the end, iatrogenically induced. And when you increase the dose to prolong the duration, you might have an increased peak time of the effect with further increase in variability. We're using trough to peak ratio in many studies to balance the blood pressure fall at the end and at the peak of the dosing interval. But this is very good for drug studies, not in individual patients. It's very poorly reproducible because you focus on a very narrow time window. That's why we propose the smoothness index, which is just calculating the difference in blood pressure between initial recording and on-treatment recording, and the average of the 24-hourly changes, the yellow bar, is put in a ratio with its own standard deviation. So the more powerful is a drug, the higher is the index, the more homogeneous is the reduction, the smallest is the standard deviation, the better is the index, which was associated inversely with blood pressure variability. The better the smoothness index, the less variable is blood pressure on treatment, which makes sense, but also the better was the regression of left ventricular hypertrophy and the reduction in the progression of carotid atherosclerosis. Which drug? We have some data indirectly suggesting that CCBs might work. Again, Peter Rothwell, retrospective data, ASCOT trial. Comparison between a beta blocker, atenolol, and amlodipine. Within visit variability, no ways. The CCB is better. The excellent study by Professor Safar comparing placebo, candesartan, indapamide, and amlodipine, the yellow bar. Again, amlodipine was the best for daytime, nighttime, 24-hour, and short-term variability. Our meta-analysis comparing placebo, short-lasting drugs, losartan, ramipril, valsartan, different dose, telmisartan, amlodipine, smoothness index, progressive increase with a duration of action. And one is a good value to reduce organ damage. Finally, further meta-analysis comparing monotherapy with combination treatment. And if you use combination treatment, you can double the smoothness index. So a very practical indication, use the combination treatment to smooth out the blood pressure profile while waiting for more evidence. The key question, does treatment reduce variability is also improving outcome? No answer. We have no intervention trial yet. That's why we are still holding before suggesting BPV in daily practice. Meta-analysis suggests that if you compare a drug with a higher or lower variability, you get when the variability is reduced, a reduction in stroke rate. But this is meta-analysis, it's not an intervention trial. So in conclusion, certainly 24-hour blood pressure mean values are predictive. We cannot disregard that an increase in variability is associated with a higher risk, although we don't know exactly what to do. Certainly we have to take care of selecting long-lasting drugs or drug combination, because at least you may smooth out a blood pressure profile. Waiting for prospective outcome studies that are currently running that might help us in this field. One is this, the REVERENT study, which is ongoing between our center, Greece and China, and the MASTER study, which is a study as ESH we are proposing to focus on MASTER and control hypertension, will also provide some information on blood pressure variability. While waiting for these results, my personal choice would be to avoid a blood pressure profile like this. I would prefer to have in my arteries something smoother. Thank you for your attention.